The properties are Balya, Brahmana and Vrishya, Malakarma, Mala Anulomana and Mastishka Poshanam. In here, this Unmada and Abhasmara, the medicines are to be prescribed in Unmada and Abhasmara. Okay, here the medicines, the Phalashruti of the medicines are to be described as Vandhya Sudapradam. Are you noticed it? So it may be this Kalyanagrada, Brahmigrada, etc. having the action to the improve the follicles and also to produce the ovulation is also. Especially in case of lean PCOS. If the patient is obese, we can select some more tikshna drugs and also to reduce the obesity. But if the patient is presented with very lean patients, what we can do? In such conditions, we are doing Varanadigrada or any oil. Not. In such conditions, we have to select the medicines which are described in Unmada, Abhasmara or Medhya preparations like Manduga Parni, then Eshti Madhu, like this Kalyanagrada and Brahmigrada, etc. Then the first step, Rukshana is over, then Snehabana is also over, the next Swedana. If you are planning Vamana, then Swedana for 1 day and Utkleshana next day. Just after 2 days, we are doing Vamana. Okay, then if you are planning Virejana, how many days we are doing Swedana? 3 days. Okay. So, in which conditions we are doing Vamana, in which conditions we are doing Virejana? So, according to the conditions of the patient, if there is obesity and then kaba, pragoba like obese PCO, we can select Vamana. If needed, there is a Pitta Shamana, if there is regular cycles, not amenorrhea, then such conditions we can select Virejana. Then, medicines for Virejana. Vamana we know. How to do Vamana? Normal, as in our clinical practice, how we are doing Vamana, that's itself. Nothing to specify in gynecological conditions like using the Madhanabala. Okay, so we are selecting Vamana or Virejana. Then, next step, medicines for Virejana. Here also, Snigdha Virejana. The medicines with Snigdha preparations are, oily preparations are to be better. To considering the gynecological conditions, except Pitta Vardhaka conditions like heavy burning, then such conditions we can use the Avibhati Churna or Ruksha Virejana. Otherwise, we can select Gandharva Eranda or Eranda preparations for the Virejana. Then next, Vasti. Vasti, then Anivasana Vasti is very important. Niryuha Vasti is also, in different formulations, Niryuha Vasti we can select. Then Madhutailika Vasti, Leghana Vasti, Kshara Vasti, then Kshira Vasti, so many conditions. Or Rajayabana Vasti, different formulations are there. So according to the condition, we can select whatever the Vasti we needed. Even Vaidharana Vasti is also beneficial in most of the Uniryogas. Then next, Uttara Vasti, it's a unique procedure for the gynecological conditions. It controls Vada in its site and other doshas, sudden effect on the target tissues. So many indications like Yoni Bramsha, Vasti Vikara, Yoni Roga, Abhara Sangha Shukra Dosha, etc. Just I passed not much clinical importance, that's why. Okay. The patient should be kept in dorsal position, then assessed by uterine. Using the uterine sound, we just depth of the uterus should be measured. Then after that, insert the cuscus bivalve speculum to the vagina. Then cannula should be fitted on the Rubin's cannula. Is normally we are using in two types. Rubin's cannula we can use. After the one use also, sterilize that instrument and again we can select. Then if it is needed more deep penetration, then IUI cannula can also use. This cannula using for the IUI procedure, intrauterine insemination, IUI procedure, that cannula we can use for the Uttara Vasti. The desired medicine should be taken within the syringe and insert or put to the uterine cavity. In cases of small tubal block, for example with mucus clot or mucus block, that will be cleared with that intrauterine, these procedures. Then Here the cervix should be visualized using this bivalve speculum. Two methods are there, intravaginal and intrauterine. Yoni purana and garbhashaya purana. Okay. So this is the Rubin's cannula we are very commonly using. Then after inserting the desired medicine through that Rubin's cannula, the post-operative procedures, the pijuba should be inserted to the vaginal canal and then speculum is removed. Allow the patient to lay down for 2 hours. Repeat the procedure for 3 days. Some medicines for the infertility practice, Mahanarayana Taila. In first cycles, we can mix some Kalyana Kshara to get a easy penetration towards the canal. Then after that, along only Taila or Grudha, we can also select. In case of tubal block, Kshara Taila is also one good choice. Then after doing the Kshara Taila for 1 or 2 cycles, then we can change that medicine to Mahanarayana Taila or Sahajaradi Taila. Then Shadpala Grudha, Phala Sarpi, Vidaryadi Grudha, according to the different conditions of the uterus and patient, we can select the medicines. So after getting the these Shodhana procedures, what the important or advantage of the Shodhana procedures? It should be correcting Rudu, Kshetra, Ambu and Bija. Okay, so here we get the proper nourishment of the endometrium. To get the implantation of the fetus, there should be nourishment of the endometrium is needed. For getting the healthy ovum, now a healthy follicle we needed. Then the passage, this fallopian tube should be corrected. So to attain these all healthy factors, this Shodhana therapy is having very, very advantages. So we have break. Nasyavith, even Dhanandara Daila, Kshirabala we are using. Then in some conditions, Varanadi Kshiragrada is also using. Very commonly we are using this Dhanandara Daila and also Kshirabala. Patients. General protocol and we discussed earlier. Then here. Some clinical conditions which coming as the three important categories like Krichartava, Amitartava and Nashtartava. We discussed earlier. Okay, so under these categories, Krichartava coming here, this is the different presentations including Vataja, Vada Kapaja, Vada Pittaja and then Vada Pradhana Sanibadika. Krichartava, that means? What is meant by Krichartava? Dysmenorrhea is the painful menstruation. So some clinical conditions which coming under the Krichartava. Here, out of this, we discussed the spasmodic dysmenorrhea and congestive dysmenorrhea. Okay. What are the spasmodic dysmenorrhea? It's most commonly in which age? Which age? Adolescent age group. Okay. Yeah, but even though, adolescent age group. So here, but not compulsory to be this spasmodic. According to the conditions, we are detailing the conditions, then only we can rule out, is it spasmodic or congestive? Okay, if a girl presented with congestive dysmenorrhea, it may be in adolescent age group, it may be presented with severe pain, which is starting from 2 or 3 days back and it is continued, then it should not be spasmodic, maybe congestive dysmenorrhea. Okay. Then here, congestive dysmenorrhea, there may be an underlying pathology will be there. What may be that pathology? These are the listed here. Here, the ovarian neoplasm, like Vada Kapaja conditions. Next, uterine fibroids. Then, endometriosis. Next, adenomyosis. Then, this we can obtain from USG or from laparoscopy or etc. Then next is the PID, pelvic inflammatory syndrome. But in the most of the cases, we can correctly diagnose the PID. Okay. In only some scan reports, what may be, in if the patient is having PID, then in USG report, what may be the findings? There may be fluid in POD, pouch of Douglas. There may be fluids. But other condition, when the fluid will come, POD, during the, in normal, one normal condition, yeah, no, not only this scan report, the POD filled with fluids. Normally, ovulation time, it's filled with fluid. In other conditions, here, it may be the sign of PID, pelvic inflammatory disease. From patient presentation, how we can diagnose? When we are asking about the patient, what is the one leading question to the patient? Lower abdominal pain, fever, mild fever may be there, but even though it is an acute condition, then only we will get fever. Then, one important leading question is that if it is if the patient is married, then dyspareunia. Dyspareunia, painful coitus, lower abdominal pain. Discharge per, maybe the discharge is not only to the, not like the leucorrhea or the yoni strava, it should not be get outside. But in PID conditions, it will be after the examination using Cusco's speculum, then only we will get the discharge from there. Not towards the external, in most cases. Low abdominal pain is the main symptom. Then next, the leading question is the dyspareunia. Okay. Next, then the treatment approach in vataja or spasmodic dysmenorrhea. There are so many drugs. The main treatment principle is what? That agnidipana, vata anulomana. Anulomana preparations will cure the spasmodic dysmenorrhea. Even vegadharana is also one of the reasons for spasmodic dysmenorrhea in many cases. Because we know the adolescent age group. And also, in most of the ladies are most habit to vegadharana. So, to avoid the vegadharana is also one remedy. Then, agnidipana and vata anulomana. Where anulomana preparations like arenda preparation daily, or that we can cure the, or reduce the spasmodic dysmenorrhea. Some preparations are there. Then, one case with primary infertility, presented with ovarian cyst. Okay, here the benign neoplasm, and also it considered as the Vata Kabaja condition. Here, the age of the patient 26 years, married since 3 years. Then, patient presentation were recurrent lower abdomen. Okay, then congestive dysmenorrhea. We explained that nature of the dysmenorrhea congestive. Then on USG report, it was 4.5 centimeter benign cyst on the ovary. So here, normally the cyst are, what's the nature of cyst? It's fluid filled. Okay. So in most of the cases, within 4 centimeter or 4.5 centimeter, they will normally, yeah, get disappeared after 1 or 2 months. In some cases. But in some cases, it may grow. That's also happening. Okay. So here is the 4.5 centimeter cyst on the ovary. That was the scan report. Here, right adnexal cyst. And there is mild PCOD changes on the left ovary also. Then the medicine started on the July 2nd week of this 2018. Started with one medicine. I prescribed that Prayantyadi Kashaya. It's Kapapitta Shamana Laegana Pagahara properties of medicine. Then Kanchanara Gugulu. I think you may be familiar. Next, Kumari, Kumari Asava and Draksharishta. And then a small dose of Gandharva Aranda. Aranda preparations mixed with Kalyanakshara. Okay. She continued these medicines. And took a USG on 17/9/2018. Because after two months of medicine, that's 4.5 centimeter cyst become disappeared. And then the next the period come, because her main clinical presentation was lower abdominal pain and congestive dyspareunia. So after attaining the next menstruation, the pain was reduced much. Not completely cured, but even though reduced much. Then again, the next cycle is not attained. But even though we are taking this Kalyanakshara and these medicines, but she got conceived on the next cycle. If we check the USG report, and it's fine that she is having 7 weeks and 4 days. In such condition, what we have to do? Because the patient is taking medicine for cyst, like Kalyanakshara, etc. So if the patient is become pregnant, then we have to stop that medicine. We have to apply one law, all or none law. If any problem will happen, that may become naturally get aborted. Here, nothing happened. Stop that medicines and continued with the garbhasthapana medicines like palasarpis, etc. And she continued the pregnancy. After that, she attained a baby with 2.78 kg. So these are the next scan report. Okay. Then coming to the next condition, uterine fibroids. I think this cyst fluid filled one, and it's very easy to manage compared to which uterine fibroid. What's the nature of this uterine fibroid? These are connective tissue and then heart mass compared to the ovarian cyst. Then most of the uterine fibroids are how? Asymptomatic. There will not be any special symptoms. Okay, in many cases, how we are diagnose the case? Some patients are complains with the then dribbling of urine, or maybe DUB, it's okay. Then congestive dyspareunia may be there, or pressure symptoms. Okay, like urinary incontinence, etc. So in such conditions, we are taking an USG and we diagnose a large mass may be there. Okay, so here the dyspareunia, then most of the conditions are asymptomatic. If the symptomatic cases, there may be menorrhagia, that's a heavy bleeding, then congestive dyspareunia. What's the reason for congestive dyspareunia? There is a congestion or pelvic congestion is there. Okay, then infertility. How these uterine fibroids causes infertility? There may be follicle is good, semen okay. Then in which condition? What's the problem due to uterine fibroid? Yeah, submucous fibroids due to the implantation. Yes. Then infertility. Then chance for abortion. Next, preterm labor. Because the food and the rasa is needed to grow both the fetus and fibroid. So there is chance for preterm labor and also growth retardation. Next, we are assessing this condition on USG. We are diagnosing, is it submucous fibroid, subserous fibroid, or intramural fibroid. Then what's the treatment principle that we have to apply? As we tell that in modern medicines, it may be like avoiding or myomectomy we can then they are doing. But what's our treatment principle? According to the presentation of the patient, clinical presentation, we can select the medicines. Because Kevala Kabaja is the one group. Then next, Pitta Samsargaja. And then other is the Vada Samsargaja. Here, the most terrible one, which is the most terrible one? Pitta Samsargaja. Because here the heavy bleeding will be there. Okay. If the mass is very large, that will cause the, if the subserous fibroid, if the fibroid is growing to outside, that will not cause problem to the, or will not cause the heavy bleeding. If it is inside the uterus, submucous fibroid, that will cause heavy bleeding and severe pain. That is much problem. Yeah, even according to the presentations, if the bleeding is asymptomatic fibroid with very large one, it's the kabaja or without any symptoms. If it is with heavy bleeding presentation, then we can consider as the pitta samsargaja. Then if it is pain and then pressure symptoms, we can consider vada samsargaja. Then next, some choice of medicines. The properties of medicine we can consider. For kabha, kevala kabaja, there should be, the selection of medicine should be lekhana properties like kshara, kalyana kshara, varanadhi kashaya, kanjanara gugulu, navayasa, etc. Okay. Then, vata samsargaja will be chirivilluadi, saptasara, sahajaradi, even though we can mix in kalyana kshara also. Then, pitta samsargaja will come. We have to select some medicines like Drakshadi, Guluchyadi, Trayindyadi, that explained earlier. Then Gugulu Tiktaga are the medicine choice. So our important aim is the not increases the bleeding. Bleeding should not be increased and the size should also needed to reduce. But the prognosis is normally compared to the ovarian cyst, I think the prognosis is very bad. Considering this uterine fibroid. The advantage is the symptomatic result will get. If there is pain, that may be reduced. If there is heavy bleeding, that can be controlled. Then what about the size of fibroid? We can convince the patient that even though it's not increasing or reduced a little. Okay. Then is a case study of a patient presented with uterine fibroid. Age is 25 years, primary infertility, presented with uterine fibroid, intramural uterine fibroid about 3.5 centimeter, I think. Then after preparation to the patient, just after doing virejana and vasti, patient got, I think after the 6 months, patient got conceived. But even though the patient conceived, the same day, the morning urine, she got the UPT positive. But at that night itself, with severe pain and abortion that happened. After she came to hospital and DNC also we done. So after I had just a second opinion, they went for a modern gynecologist. But the gynecologist also told that not needed to remove the fibroid because it's very small size, about 3.1 or 2 centimeter. It's not needed to remove or not needed to do the myomectomy. You may conceive, no problem. And also advised some folic acid also. Then she came again. After that, all shodhana therapies are done using Gugulu Tiktaka Grudha, this Snehabana done. Then Vasti, Uttravasti, everything practiced. And after that, she conceived. Then Garbhasthapana medicines also followed after she get a healthy baby. So in some cases, this small uterine fibroid may also become problem. Then next, dyspareunia reaching case is the endometriosis. Here, the three cardinal features for endometriosis, what are they? Congestive dyspareunia, progressively increasing congestive dyspareunia. That means increasing. After the periods also, the pain is get increasing. Then dysuria. Even during the period time, pain during urination also. Then dyspareunia. It's a painful coitus. In patients like more nervousness, the pain on the starting itself. But in case of this endometriosis pain, that would be to the deep penetration. What may be the reason? Yes, additions may be there. So that's the reason for penetration or deep pain during the dyspareunia. So here our the consideration of this utavarta and vadhiki yoni vyabhat. So the treatment principles and treatment things to be incorporated with the utavarta and vadhiki. Here also this anulomana treatment have to done. Including this Pachanamrita, Saptasara, Rasna, Dashmula, Grudha, etc. We can use, and also the previously discussed shodhana therapy is also very important, like snehabana, vasti, uttravasti, etc. will give much result in this endometriosis. Here, which is the most favorite site of endometrial tissues other than uterus? Which is the most favorite site of the endometrial tissues other than uterus? The first important site? Ovary, okay, we know. Because what's the forming there? Chocolate cyst. The first sign. Then, what are the other sites? Fallopian tube, okay. Then, peritoneal tissues. Then, scar endometriosis. Are you heard about? Are you experienced from any patients? It's severe pain. The patient will come like a completely down. Scar endometriosis. After the cesarean scar, the endometrial tissues will attain, and that will